Good afternoon, everybody. May I have your attention, please? We are about to start this. May I have your attention, please? Thank you so much. We are about to start this service of celebration for PLUKE this afternoon, and we want to honor the family. We want to honor all of you this afternoon as we begin these proceedings. Most of all, first and foremost, we want to honor God, who has given us such a wonderful day, a blessed day. Yeah, it's hot, it's humid, but this is Bermuda in July, so it's no surprise to us. And so as we gather this afternoon to celebrate PLUKE's legacy and to celebrate his homegoing service, can we all stand, please, other than the family, immediate family? You may remain seated if you choose, but the rest of us, would we stand as if funeral directors make their way? This is indeed a sight to see, the support that everybody feels with representation from all facets of our community. And I can assure you the family are very, very happy that you have come to show your love and support as we say farewell for a while to PLUKE. Now, we're going to sing a song this afternoon. The song before we start the proceedings is simply called "This Is the Day." Regardless of what you think about the day or how you feel about the day, it's still the day that the Lord has made. And regardless of what's going on, we should rejoice and be glad in it. Can I see the hands of those that know this? Oh, we're going to have a choir this afternoon. This is the day that the Lord has made, Brother John. Can we get a clap going too, please? Subject to be very long, but it is subject to change. Yes, it is. And we've already instituted one change by inserting a chorus. And so we want to just make the atmosphere light and lively. All indications about this is that it should be heavy. But we want to celebrate whatever Pluke meant to you over the years. Some of us watched him grow. Some grew up with him. Some are closely related to him. Whatever he was to you, by the fact that you are here today, he was somewhat close and good to you. And you are fond of him to show up today. And so, as we come this afternoon, the program's just going to change slightly because I believe we should go before the throne of grace in prayer. And so, Pastor Milton Burgess from St. Luke Amy Church will come. Right after that, we're going to have a hymn of celebration by Reverend Blanche Burchill and Reverend Carolyn Armstrong as they come in that order. Praise God.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Praise the Lord. On behalf of my mother, my wife, my daughters, and the St. Luke Amy Church family, our prayers are with you. For we understand that earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. I'm going to miss my brother. Because this time of the year, we had many discussions. And I oftentimes asked, will Cleveland County have a team, especially when it came to play Bayless Bay? Anybody here from Cleveland? Anybody here from? Apparently there's no one here from Cleveland County this afternoon. And just take the hand of the person next to you. Our gracious and eternal and loving God, in the precious and matchless name of Jesus we come. Father, we bless this afternoon to be able to feel the heat. Some people can't even feel the heat this afternoon. But Father, we give you praise and we give you honor, we give you glory. How great is our God. Father, from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, we will bless you. We will magnify the name that's above every name. At the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the honor and glory of God. Father, we come to celebrate the life of our dear brother. First of all, Father, I thank you for the word that had been seeded here by godly parents. Father, that saw fit that he went to Sunday school and church. That saw fit that the word was planted in him before he knew himself. I thank you for loaning him to us for this season. Though a young man, he impacted so many lives. I thank you for his wonderful family this afternoon. Comfort this family as only you can. Father, I pray that this afternoon someone will come to know and accept you as Lord and Savior of their life. Show yourself great and awesome in this house today. And I thank you that something about his life, Father, would impact every life that's here today. In the precious and matchless name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen.
Grateful to be here this afternoon, and I want to say to Aunt Barbara, is the mic on? Okay. On? All right. Aunt Barbara and Uncle Carlton. God is good to us, and we're grateful for a time that we can come and celebrate PLUKE. I'm looking at that smile. Thank you, PLUKE, for your smile. Today it's our request, it's been requested that we sing one of PLUKE's favorite songs, Somebody Bigger Than You and I. And there is somebody bigger than us. And when we don't understand days like this, we rest in him. We rest in his promises. Be blessed as we sing this song in Jesus' name. technology. All right. Mm-hmm. Glad to have my sister with me this afternoon, and we pray that you're blessed by this hymn of the church.
Who made the mountain? Who made the trees? Who made the river flow to the seas? And who hung the moon in the starry sky? Somebody bigger than you and I. Who made the flowers bloom in the spring? And who writes the song for the robin to sing? And who sends the rain when the earth is dry? Somebody bigger than you and I. He lights the way when the road is long. He'll keep you company with love to guide you. He'll walk beside you just like he walks with me. When I am weary, filled with despair, who gives me courage to go on from there? And who gives me faith that will never die? Somebody bigger than you and I. When I am weary, filled with despair.
That's the moment you're having now.
Who gives me courage to go on from there? And who gives me strength that will never die? Somebody bigger than you and I. He lights the way when the road is long. He'll keep you company with love to guide you. He'll walk beside you just like he walks with me. When I am weary, filled with despair, who gives me courage to go on from there? And who gives me faith that will never die? Jesus is bigger than you. Jesus is bigger than you. Jesus is bigger than you. And I.
Have a couple of housekeeping details to take care of. First of all, we want to make sure that we are abiding under the COVID regulations, and we see everybody nitty and tight. If that's your bubble, then you are okay. If that's not your bubble, then if you would distance yourself if you're not masked up. That's all we ask of you today. And thank you so much. Also, I want to acknowledge all the pastoral care that is here in support of this family, Pastor Joseph Whalen, the pastor of Marsden First United Methodist Church. I also see Pastor Joseph King from Gospel Tabernacle, and of course, Pastor Birchall, who is from Glory Temple, Pastor Carolyn Armstrong from Rhema Ministries, Pastor Milton Burgess from St. Luke AME Church. And I don't know if I've seen any others. If I've missed you, I do apologize. Pastor George Smith is here, the associate pastor of Open Door Christian Assembly. And my name is Pastor Dean Smith. I am the senior pastor at Open Door Christian Assembly. We also want to acknowledge Son of the Soil, MP Derek Burgess, and who is here supporting the family. He comes from the alley. We know the alley. Pluke's from the alley. And the Smiths are from the alley. My wife's from the alley. Most of you are from the alley. If you're not there now, you were there at some point, or you moved through. And so we celebrate this afternoon. Amen. And to Ms. Smith, Mr. Smith, Kawanda, Ina, and to all of the family, we collectively and individually extend to you our heartfelt condolences. And please know, these are not just words. We are, we will, and we have been praying your strength in the Lord. Moving on with the program this afternoon, may we please have Jamaica Talbot, and right after that, we will have a musical selection by Samantha Smith, and then the tributes from Harrington Workman's Club, Harrington Hundreds, and a family tribute by Rhonda Daniels Pitt, in that order, please.
From the New Living Translation, Psalms 139. O Lord, you have examined my heart and know everything about me. You know when I sit down or stand up. You know my thoughts even when I'm far away. You see me when I travel and when I rest at home. You know everything I do. Know what I am going to say even before I say it, Lord. You go before me and follow me. You place your hand of blessings on my head. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too great for me to understand. I can never escape from your spirit. I can never get away from your presence. If I go up to heaven, you are there. If I go down to the grave, you are there. If I ride the wings of the morning, if I dwell by the farthest oceans, even through your hands will guide me, and your strength will support me. I could ask the darkness to hide me, and the light around me to become night. But even in the darkness, I cannot hide from you. To you, the night shines as bright as day. Darkness and light are the same to you. You made all the delicate inner parts of my body and knit me together in my mother's womb. Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I know it. You watch me as I bring form in outer seclusion, as I woven together in the dark of the womb. You saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed. How precious are your thoughts about me, O God. They cannot be numbered. I can't even count them. They outnumber the grains of sand. And when I wake up, you are still with me. O God, if only you could destroy the wicked, Get out of my life, you murderers. They blaspheme you. Your enemies misuse your name. O Lord, shouldn't I hate those who hate you? Shouldn't I despise those who oppose you? Yes, I hate them with total hatred. From your enemies are my enemies. For your enemies are my enemies. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. Point out everything in me that offends you, and lead me along the path of everlasting life. May the words of the book be heard by many. Amen.
Good afternoon, everybody. So this song was selected by Ina. And as I was practicing this song and just thinking about Pluke's life and what you as a family must be going through right now, this scripture verse came to me. For I know the plans I have towards you, plans of good and not of evil, plans to bring you to an expected end. So as I sing this song, when Jesus says yes, nobody can say no. Just know that no matter what it feels like right now, that God plans to bring you to an expected end and a good end. I pray that this song blesses you. And you can sing along too. When Jesus says yes, nobody can say no.
All belongs to you, and Jesus says yes. When Jesus says
Jesus says yes, nobody can say no.
When Jesus says yes, nobody can say no.
When Jesus picks you up, no one can pull you down.
When Jesus says yes, nobody can say no.
When he decides to turn your whole life around.
When Jesus says yes, nobody can say no.
When Jesus says yes, nobody can.
Fraternity, just got a little housekeeping myself to do, and that's with Reverend Milton Burgess, who continuously tried to recruit around here. And I told him once before, he was around here for a few years. He didn't convert himself to blue and white, so we had a little word with the bishop, and he ended up back in St. David's. A lot of things that this afternoon, I know we're all here, and I know if PLUKE would have won the toss on a day like today, he would have told the team we're betting, and bet as long as you can. And if he didn't win the toss, he would have been bargaining with the opposing captain to still bet, because that's what he loved to do. But he is worthy of all your outpouring. And I am blown away by the support that you've shown to his family and to our cricket club and to the community. One thing for sure, I wish we would have bought that bench over here and put it right in the middle as well, because a lot of things, I mean, even like today is a Monday afternoon, and he would have been preparing for his juniors and spent a lot of time. We spent a lot of time on that bench. But I'm going to do the formal version because the cricketers didn't want you to hear the dressing room stuff. And as he was president, he deserves all that. Good day, family. I stand before you to pay tribute to Carlton PLUKE Smith on behalf of the Four Seas family and the wider community of Devil's Hill, Harris's Bay, Tuckerstown, as well as the entire ECCA community. There has already been an outpouring of love and genuine signs of respect and admiration, which speaks volumes of the personality that PLUKE demonstrated throughout the community and cricket fraternity. PLUKE was a leader with a servant's heart, not afraid to give service and serve throughout this community, and was very often in the trenches himself to get things done. The most important qualities of a good leader include integrity, accountability, apathy, humility, resilience, vision, influence, and positivity. Some might argue whether he had all these qualities, and at times even labeled him a dictator. Sometimes he had to make hard decisions that every leader would have to make at some time or the other that may have left some people with their nerves out of joint. He did what he had to do as leader, especially others shied away from their duties. But one thing was very clear. His motives were always for the betterment of his beloved Four Seas. Carlton did his apprenticeship like every other young man in the community, playing cricket in Frog Alley streets, graduating to junior county, league cricket, then senior county. He eventually became captain and ultimately president of the PLUKE. I don't personally remember him being on a winning team for Senior County, but he was certainly a proud but he was certainly a proud president when we won the cup in 2014 after 33-year wait in the county victory wilderness. We actually got the cup before that when St. Davis decided to give it to us, but he didn't count that as a victory. I remember saying to him, I'm extremely happy for this victory. Now the monkey can be removed from my back, as I was the captain that lost the cup to St. Davis in 1981. I can now retire from being involved officially with PLUKE cricket. His response to me was, you and Tink aren't going anywhere. I need you guys around to impart some wisdom from your experiences and keep me on track. He said, we will never ever be in that predicament again. If we can win Junior County, there is no reason why we shouldn't win the Senior County. We have enough juniors coming through the ranks to fulfill any role we need. One of his desires was to see all juniors make it at senior level. He never forgot how he got his start in cricket and made it his goal to service the youngsters on the club's behalf. He was especially proud when his son Isaiah, and godson Kiyoshi and Kishai made Senior County team. I read a quote the other day while doing my daily devotions that said, they won't realize how big a part you play until you're not there to play it anymore. How fitting is that quote when it is applied to PLUKE? He and his team of coaches work with on the 11s, 8s, 13s, and 16s, and of course the Junior County team, and won many titles in those divisions. They created a working relationship with parents to ensure the children would be safe and enjoy their cricket experience. If the teams played during the week, they would arrange for them to be fed so that all they had to do upon returning home was get a bath, complete homework, and go to bed, making sure players had transport to and from games. Who can forget the glorious rides in the back of his truck after the glorious Junior County victories, arranging for prize presentations with a swim in the pool? PLUKE was driven to get the best out of all players. That ferocious shout across the field to encourage you to pick your game up, but also making one feel a bit agitated, but also complimenting you for good performances. I'm sure you will still hear his voice in future games, but you won't be able to shout back at him. PLUKE worked hard so that everyone could have a good time at the club and throughout the community. He had a good relationship with the district police to keep things in check. Remember those cutfish breakfasts, and especially the al fresco breakfast on International Race Weekend to raise funds for cricket tours abroad? He was instrumental in taking the club on a tour to the UK. The players had a great time, both on and off the field, and I am told it was a good cultural experience. That's all they would tell me. I wasn't there, so I take their word for it. But they say what happened in the UK must stay in the UK. What about those lobster and fish fries that he and Wilton and Paul put together? The walk and run fundraiser around the sun to keep fit and raise funds at the same time. What about the prestigious Ellie versus South Shore Good Friday match, a special rivalry between him and the mayor? PLUKE could be found at the club late at night or early mornings preparing for these and other events. He used to prepare for the victory parties after county games, especially after that infamous breakthrough over the two-year run in 2014, Reverend. A few times I came across the club and saw the windows all taped up. So I said, hey, were you painting at the club last night? How come you didn't give me a call to assist? He just smiled at me and said, we didn't need you for this project. Other times I would find him at the club working on the infrastructure or taking a break on the infamous wall across the club. He dubbed that the wall of wisdom, because all sorts of ideas were floated while sitting on the wall, and he could explain his vision for the club as well. Remember the quote that I said previously, they won't realize how big a part you play until you're not there to play it anymore. That keeps playing across my mind. Well, it is time for us to fulfill his legacy of changing the perception that nothing good will come out of devil's hole. He believed that we could be a cricket club to be reckoned with and have a club that served the community well. We need you all to play a part in keeping his work and dream alive. How many of you are willing to step up to the plate? He is already amiss at team strategy meetings and coordinating the juniors and seniors. I know he had a few things left on his bucket list to fulfill, to take his beloved juniors on an overseas tour, to watch his nephew play in England, and that three players from the junior ranks will make senior county this year. I'm not going to name them, but if they play hard enough, his dream will be fulfilled. A big thank you to his family and loved ones for the sacrifices he made on our behalf, from the officers and members of the Four Seas family. PLUKE represented the club in a total of 14 county games. He was a colt in 1992 and retired from county in 2008. Somehow in his records, he was missing in 93, 94, and 95. I don't know whether it was because he got a dock in 92 and didn't return until he was able to come back. But according to the records, he did have one dock. He had two not outs. His highest score was 48 not out. His batting average was 15.7. He bowled 22.1 overs and took 5 wickets for 83 runs. I have a few comments from Stephen Douglas, the Eastern County president. My early memories of PLUKE is a young Carlton Smith Jr. singing solos at St. Philip's Church many years ago. Yes, he could sing. He came into cricket. He always said he never wanted to be leader, but leadership roles were a natural fit for him. When something was on his mind to share, he would call me. I would listen to his views, which he backed up very well with his reasoning. At the ECCA, his heart was junior county and player development. As he said on numerous occasions, the bunch of guys he brought through would win the county cup on a regular basis because they were successful as juniors. As for the ECCA meetings, when he filled in as rep for the club, he would often come late because of junior training was his first priority. He would ask the straightforward questions, no beating around the bush. On one occasion, I remember, some people were campaigning to get a no-confidence vote against myself as president. PLUKE informed me of their intention before the meeting, said he had my back. When he arrived at the meeting, and when it was his turn to speak, he asked, why is the president still in the chair? I thought some of you were seeking to get rid of him. One gentleman replied, we still have a lot to learn. The last time I saw PLUKE, I had dropped by Pokey Oak Estate to see my son. We chatted as normal, and he said the rain was coming, so he was knocking off early and left. PLUKE has played a magnificent all-round innings for his club and community, both on and off the field. His innings has come to an end for us a lot earlier than a lot of us would like, but he has made a mark for us to continue to build on. He will be a great miss to the club and the ECCA wider community. Thank you on behalf of the officers and members of Carlton Workman Cleveland County Cricket Club.
Members of Parliament, members of the Flats Victoria, the community clubs, all which PLUKE was a very fond member of. I'm here today on behalf of the management and staff of the Harrington Hundreds Rotary Store, where PLUKE always came by at all different times. He started in the morning, he'll come for his father's newspaper, he'll drop his money in and he'll go. But then PLUKE would always appear when you least expected, when it was time for something to eat. PLUKE would come on by and I'm like, PLUKE, it's a little early for lunch. But then he would say, well, hey, I'm hungry. Well, what's on the menu today? I'm like, PLUKE, well, what are we doing? But I'm here today to say PLUKE was a very kind-hearted individual. He was a very loving individual, and he always had time to listen to the people of Smith's Parish, listen to me, because we would always get in the aisle, and we would always talk, and we'd always have fun. He would rough up my cashiers, and he'll say nice things in it. But the most important part of this whole thing today is that he always loved his family. His most important things was his dear friend, his life's partner, Ina, and the children, obviously his mother and his father, his sister, his brother-in-law, his nephews, and all everybody that made PLUKE accepted in his heart. So all I want to say today is, Mr. PLUKE, I'm going to miss you, because when I need my windows fixed, you can't come to Mount Hill and fix my window. You can't tell me you're going to meet me at 12 o'clock and show up at 12:30 and sit on the planter, have your Kentucky Fried Chicken, and then want to ask me for something to drink. How you like that? So, Mr. PLUKE, Carlton Smith, you the man. I was saddened on June the 21st when I found out I was out having dinner with my wife on my birthday, and I got the news. I said, oh no. So I raised my glass and I said, PLUKE, this one's for you, my friend. This one's for you, for all the things you've done, for all the things you've said that made the people of Smith's Parish very happy. Today we salute Carlton PLUKE Smith. And we say, farewell, farewell. You've earned your wings. You've earned your respect from the community and from us here at Harrington Hundreds. So long, my friend. So long.
Have to bring up the rear. Good afternoon, everyone, to Aunt Barbara and Kawanda and Ina and Rye and Zai and Adrian and Ina's family and the Smith family, the Daniels family, the Cleveland County family, the clergy family. Good afternoon. I'm happy to have been asked to give a little tribute to my cousin PLUKE. I can't be solemn because PLUKE was never solemn. So just bear with me, because some of my jokes may go over your head. Ever since I can remember, PLUKE has been PLUKE. Uncle Carlton came up with the name, but I don't think anybody can recall why he gave him that name. So what does the word PLUKE mean? Me being inquisitive, I Googled it. And I was surprised by what I found. It's of Scottish origin. And the description that I read said this: most frequently spotted on a teenager's forehead, the PLUKE, spelled P-L-U-K-E, or P-L-O-O-K, or P-L-O-U-K, marks the growing pains of all adolescence. So in case you didn't get it, a PLUKE is a spot or a pimple, okay? And it also refers to a PLUKE as the sound of a pimple when it pops. Let me categorically say, PLUKE was not a pimple. Our PLUKE was exasperating, yet loving. Heavy-handed, yet gentle. Always laughing, rarely irritated, and extremely mischievous. PLUKE loved to tease you, and if he knew you did not like it, he would harass you and persist in teasing you until you accepted it. Most of us grew up on Ma's house on Somersault Road or the alley, with Aunt Barbara and Uncle Carlton living next door. And being children, we were in and out of both houses, especially during the summertime. We all were close because cousins are usually the first real friends that we have as children. When Pluke was born, he was a gorgeous baby, beautiful, average size. To his older female cousins, he was their live baby doll. His nickname should have been Tonka, because as a little boy, he loved playing with his Tonka trucks. One particular truck was big enough for him to sit on and move around using his feet. He was headstrong too and would cry if things didn't go his way. But he was a great brother when Kawanda came along a few years later. Through the years, as we became adults, we went our separate ways. Some of us went abroad for further education. Some of us got married and divorced and married again. But Pluke was always around. Even though we might not have seen each other, he always greeted us the same. He was the best man in Lolly's wedding and a groomsman in Kyle's wedding, where he had the honor of walking with me. We were delighted that Pluke grew up to be a big, tall, strapping man who would become a cricket star and be devoted and loyal to the Cleveland community and his long-term significant other and boo, Ina. Asking a few of the cousins about their favorite memory of Pluke, this is what they said. Roxy, when Pluke was about 3 years old, our house was under construction. There was an iron bar that was used to push out windows. For some reason, he wailed me with it. My mom shouted out to him, "Pluke, you shouldn't do that." I knew right there then that he would be a cricketer. As big as he was and as old as he would still let me call him Plukey in public. Kyle, I'm a Yankees fan and Pluke is a Red Sox fan. Every time Marsh and I would go to Boston, he would ask me to hook him up with some Red Sox gear. I'd tell him no, because we were rivals. But then I'd agree, okay, fine, I'll get it. The stipulation was that the gear would have to go in Marsh's suitcase. No way was I putting that in my suitcase. If he were here today, he would call and heckle me because the Yankees and the Sox have played 6 times so far and the Sox have won every game. I will miss Pluke because whenever there was a cricket game in Somerset, especially at White Hill Field, he and Ina would stop by. He was the only person who would never call before he came. Lolly, when we were younger, Pluke would send us out to the Midstar Cafe to get him a burger or a beef pie. He would give us the money and knew how much change we had to bring back. He would ask for it the moment we walked into the house. Pluke was also protective of me. We would travel to school on the Barclay bus, and even though he got on the bus in Devil's Hole, he would make sure there was a seat for me when the bus got to Hermitage Road. Despite the fact that people were standing, it did not matter. There was a seat waiting for me. Rion, when I was little, my mom would take me over to Uncle Carlton and Aunt Barbara's house so that I could swim in the pool. Pluke would be there too, and we would be skylarking. I would swim as far as I could underwater, and when I would try to come up for air, Pluke would hold his hand over my head to prevent me from coming up for air, laughing the whole time. And Paula, although I was not around much, what I remember the most about Pluke was that he was always smiling or laughing whenever I saw him. He was always the same. Yes, Pluke was always the same. When he smiled with his whole face. There was no pretend smiling with him. He was passionate about cricket and would always rib me for not liking the game. I can't stand cricket. Sorry, Cleveland. When he would come to visit Aunt V's, who was his godmother, he would scoop her up in his arms and she would say, always, "Pluke, put me down." There was an extraordinary connection between Pluke and Aunt V's. Each time she was in the hospital, he'd be admitted as well. This last time when she went in, he was admitted the next day and then was flown out to Boston. Aunt V's passed away on May 31st. Imagine our shock when we were told Pluke had passed away exactly 3 weeks after Aunt V's. The size of our family is shrinking, and the hole in our hearts is growing stronger and growing larger. But there is comfort in knowing that at least he has been welcomed by his family to his new home. In closing, I read this poem especially for Uncle Carlton, Aunt Barbara, Ina, Kawanda, Adrian, Rye, and Zai. We can shed tears because he is gone, or we can smile because he has lived. We can close our eyes and pray that he will come back, or we can open our eyes and see all that he has left. Our hearts can be empty because we can't see him, or we can be full of the love that we have shared with him. We can turn our back on tomorrow and live yesterday, or we can be happy for tomorrow because of yesterday. We can remember him and only that he's gone, or we can cherish his memory and let it live on. We can cry and close our minds, be empty and turn our backs, or we could do what PLUKE would want us to do, smile, laugh, open our eyes, love, and go on. Thank you.
Continue now with the intimate tributes. CP, from the day we met, who would have thought we would have been through everything together? You met me with three sons, and you loved each one unconditionally to their character. You made a deep connection with Isaiah, who you took under your wing and accepted him as your own. Nothing could separate this bond. Our first date was out the club. Wow. As time went by, you didn't see one without the other. Our connection was insurmountable. Even though I'm a Bayless Bay girl, I supported you to the fullest, cheering on the sidelines and becoming T-girl. Blue Drink was the hit. As time moved on, you stepped in for president of Cleveland County Cricket Club. I watched your leadership change gear and supported you in that role for about 7 years. Hanging out the club till closing, preparing cutfish breakfast on Sundays, anything you asked of me. I did my best to make you happy. We took many trips alone and as a family. Those memories will always be etched in my heart. Carlton, PLUKE, CP, each name I called you by, you knew the mood. We took our final plane ride on May 25th, 2021. Who would have thought it would have been the last? There's no limit to our love. I was with you till the end at your bedside. You were my soulmate, husband. Didn't need it on paper to prove that. It was in our hearts. Until death do us part. I will cherish every moment we shared for 19 years, forever. Until we meet again, love, Ina. Hugs and kisses. Hey, Daddy, it's your one and only son, Isaiah. I never thought I'd be speaking at something like this or at a time like this. You know all the things that you did for me, taking care of me, and did things for me that no other guy would do. You didn't even have to put me under your wing, but you chose to do so. You chose to be a father figure for me, all the way from 2.5 years old until you shut your eyes. I just want to let you know that I appreciate that. There are not much words I can say that can describe the type of man you were for me. I just want you to know that you will truly be a miss. I will always love you. You are just gone too soon. Just say hi and wait for me at the gates when I come see you again. I love you, man. I will always love you. I remember those days when you picked me up from school and I would just be ready to drink your orange sodas. Just knew that you would stop at the next store and buy another. You picked me up from Gwen's, Lyceum, Francis Patton, Clearwater, Cedar Bridge, all the schools that I attended. You didn't have to, but you did. Took so much pride into what I liked, which was sports, football, and cricket. You always set a challenge for me. Even though you liked cricket, and it was football that I liked, you always set a challenge score of this much girls, or if your team wins by this much girls, I'll get you something. Always pushing me to do better, go beyond. I would have never thought a guy like me would have been able to experience that type of fatherly love from another man. And you were not my biological father, but you showed me that's possible. You showed me that anything is possible. Love, Isaiah. Uncle Pluke. Uncle Pluke was my role model. He was my dream uncle. He took me for drives, he got me food, and way more. I look at Uncle Pluke and feel proud to be his nephew. Love, Nazai. Pluke, your love for us is indescribable. Although you didn't say it directly, it was shown through the many times you took us with you on trips in the truck to cricket games, or just a drive to hang in the open back of the truck. You had a strong appreciation for the club and your community. You did lots of work in the community and will be an inspiration to myself and the entire family. You have left a void in the family that will never be filled. While we mourn today, we also take comfort and joy in the fact that your mission on earth has been fulfilled. We thank the Lord for your life and bid you farewell until we meet again. Love, Zarai. Now, let's talk about Pluke. Carlton Philip Pluke Smith. After several hours of his mom, Barbara, and his dad, Carlton, who walked for many hours between Somersault Road and Painters Road and back to induce labor on June 3rd, 1966, Carlton Pluke Smith finally made his appearance into the world. His nickname Pluke was given to him by his dad with an unknown origin. Pluke was the proud big brother of Kawanda. Pluke attended Sunday school at the age of one at St. Philip Amy Church with his father, who was currently the Sunday school superintendent. Pluke's melodious voice could be heard in the sunbeams, where at the age of four, he sang many solos and was often taken to various churches to sing his favorite song. There is no secret what God can do. Up into his adult life, you would often hear him singing or humming to this song. As a youth and in his later years, he sang in the youth choir and the men's day choir. He readily accepted invitations to support the church in whatever capacity, including modeling and fashion shows. His early education began at Harrington Sound Primary School and furthered at the Barclay Institute, where he was a proud Barclayite for 4 years. Respike Finem. And then on to Bridgeton Academy in Maine, where he received his high school diploma. From there, he attended North Carolina A&T State University for one semester before cashing out to begin his journey of doing things his way. Pluke started his working career at Pink Beach Club as a bellman, where he made many friends. He was later employed by the Sandpiper Limited, working on the front desk on Sundays to avoid going to church because the pastor spoke too long. He was also a maintenance man as the years passed by. His dad's fondest memory was that he was a good child. At the age of eight, he used to make kites with his son using corn sticks. Pluke always teased his dad and shared many jokes throughout the years, and one of the famous ones was the joke. The joke. Uncle Carlton was running for the PLP right down here in Smith South back in the 1980s. He was new to all of this, had never spoken in front of the public. So he was heading to a press conference, and as soon as he got there, the reporter put the mic right in front of him, and he just froze and said, And when Pluke got a hold of that story, he never let him live it down. He teased him all the time. His mom's fondest memory In later years, the joke was on Pluke. When Pluke assisted his father to his appointments, his dad would jokingly tell people that Pluke was his daddy. His mom's fondest memory was that while traveling with his aunt to take him to school, at the mall, Pluke played as if he did not have anything to eat and told his mom that he was hungry. Unbeknownst to him, his mom knew already he had sneakily eaten because the ketchup stains were all in the front of his shirt. As a child, his mom packed his own insulated bag with his personal stash of chicken for the Sunday school picnic. Where there was plenty of food? No, there was plenty of food there. Pluke was indeed a foodie. He enjoyed KFC's chicken breasts and enjoyed sharing the breast burn with his mom, who looked forward to it every time he ate KFC. Kawanda's fondest memory with Pluke was at the age of 14, as their mom was upstairs resting, they sneakily pushed the car out the yard and he allowed her to drive. She's 14, okay? She's 14. And they went off to Bailey's Bay Cricket Club in broad daylight to attend a cricket game. True partners in crime. When mom and dad went on their extended vacations, the set was on. They threw house parties at 22 Somersault Road. Pluke, in his early years, roamed the neighborhood with his childhood friends, Jay and Jerry Jones, Carl Gibbons, Curtis Jackson, Mark and Clyde Richards, and Colin Bo Smith, and can often be seen in and out of each other's homes. Pluke traveled to many countries, such as the Caribbean, Canada, the USA, and the UK. However, he became a big fan and a repeat visitor of Las Vegas. He often traveled with his dad to Las Vegas for big boxing matches. Pluke introduced his nephew Zarai to cricket at the age of 4, where he put a tennis ball inside of a long sock on a fishing line and tied it from a tree in his backyard to help Zarai with batting. Pluke was determined that his nephew would develop into an outstanding cricketer. Nazar recalls that when driving about with Uncle Pluke, he would toot and holler out to everybody and wondered how his Uncle Pluke could know so many people. He once said, "Pluke, you're Bermuda famous, isn't it?" His brother-in-law, Adrian, remembers a time while working together. He mistakenly called him Carlton Jr. Pluke bellowed out, "Hey, buddy, I'm Pluke, not Carlton Jr., okay?" Pluke was actively involved in the Harrington Workmen's Club, the home of Cleveland County Cricket Club, where he served as president, holding codfish breakfast and to end alfresco dining, Halloween and Christmas parties, and introduced the Good Friday activities at Warriors Field, which consisted of Easter egg hunts, fun castles, and all things that children and the community loved. During his presidency, he led the historic return of the Cup to the Devil's Hole community. He was captain of the cricket team, where he was an all-rounder. He ran the youth program and was coach for the under-11s. Pluke dedicated himself to young people and mastered the concept that it is better to give than to receive by treating them after every game. This included barbecues, spaghetti dinners, snowball treats, to name a few, for the youth during the cricket season. He could often be seen with a truckload of children that looked up to him. You see, Pluke bled blue and white. In November 23rd, 2002, while doing a scavenger hunt, which ended up at the Harrington Workman's Club, he had his eyes on one particular person. Ina Trot, a Bayless Bay girl, the red and white, to which he converted to the blue and white. There were two Geminis, only to come up with the same agreement, love. Pluke instantly took to her kids and had a special bond with Isaiah from the age of 2 years old. Pluke was welcomed into the Trot family and was the life of the party to any family gathering they would have. In the last 2 years, Pluke was based at his dad's house, maintaining the property, helping his dad in the vegetable garden, and accompanying him to his various appointments. In 2018, Pluke returned to his childhood church, where he quietly sat at the back right-hand side on Sunday mornings. Church closure as a result of the pandemic prevented him from attending as he so desired. Pluke would repeatedly ask his mom, "When will the church be reopening?" On May 25, 2021, Pluke suddenly took sick and was airlifted to the Lehigh Clinic in Boston. After a month-long challenge, it was there that he was surrounded by his immediate family when God called him home on June 21st, 2021. The family would like to take this opportunity to thank all of you for attending this service of celebration in memory of Carlton PLUKE Smith. Your words of support, prayers, telephone calls, encouragement, cards, and other expressions of kindness have been a great inspiration at this time. Special thanks to the doctors and nurses of the Leahy Hospital Medical Center, Augustus Funeral Home, Pastor Dean Smith, Reverend Milton Burgess, Maxita Painter, Francis Breary, Rodlin Trott, Vanessa Bean, Santia Jones, the Cleveland County Cricket Club, / Harrington Workman's Club, and the Devil's Hole family, D.A. Jaff. May God continue to bless you all.
Good afternoon, family, and my sincere condolences to PLUKE's family, the immediate family, all his friends, and judging by the comments that have been made, all the tributes, PLUKE did it his way. Hence, the family has asked me if I would pay tribute to him by singing My Way. And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friends, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full. I've traveled each and every highway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Regrets I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do. I saw it through without exemption. I planned each chartered course, each careful step along the byway. And more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall and did it my way. I've loved, I've laughed and I've cried. I've had my fill, my share of losing. And now, as tears subside, I find it all so amusing. To think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way,
Luke and I had, even though I am exactly 10 years his senior, but we had some things in common, I'm finding out. Number one, we were taken to Sunday school at the age of one. I believe I was taken before then. Number two, we both started our working careers at the very famous Pink Beach Club, right across the way. At that time, that was arguably the best cottage colony in the world. Thank you, Jesus. Number three, we both spent a lot of time on this cricket pitch right here. Didn't Pluke open the innings? Wasn't he the opening bat? And so was I. We spent a lot of time here docking bouncers and honing our skills as an opening bat. And in that day, we were told that if you were the opening bat, all you had to do was wear down the shine off the ball, and those coming behind you would get the runs. Make the opening bowlers tired, and then let the other ones, what they call the stroke makers, come and do the rest. I don't know which skippers he played under, but I had the privilege of playing under the leadership of Robert Simons, McNeil McGowan, and Alan Douglas. And that span lasted years before, like Pluke, we went to work and we let the others play cricket. But the times that we spent on this field, most memorable times, of which we are so very proud and so very grateful for our athletic abilities. There are two sides to every coin, and there are two sides to every occasion. There is the happy side, and there is the somewhat somber side, or the serious side. I'm not tasked in bringing more tributes, because I'm going to miss Pluke as I turned in the gate to come home, and he was either backing up the truck to go up the club, or, as everybody has already said, sitting on the wall eating some chicken, or coming out of D&C Grill with a bag in his hand. I don't know what was in it, but we know it was something hot. So we're going to miss those days. Everybody on Club Road that would come up and see Pluke almost every day at his task, making sure that the club had what it needed and the players had what they needed. And so today, truly, we can celebrate. But I have a deeper task this afternoon, and I'm glad you're all here. I want to say to you that God is more interested in our eternal destiny and future than in our present circumstances. God is more interested in your eternal future and destiny than in your present circumstances. And yes, we do go through a whole lot of stuff in life that is not pleasant. And God knows about it. But I will say to you that John 3:16 proves that God is more interested in where you're going than what you're going through. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life." Nothing in that statement refers to your present experience, but to where you go when you trust Jesus. I want to share with you this afternoon for a few moments a conversation that a man is having with his son. And the conversation is by a man who was arguably the wisest and also richest man who ever lived. His name was Solomon. You know Solomon. And he has a conversation with his son. And I pick it up in Proverbs chapter 19, verse 20 and 21. But the conversation doesn't start in chapter 19. The conversation starts in chapter 1. When Solomon tells his son, "Hear, my son, the instructions of a father, and give attention to know wisdom and understanding." And a lot of dialogue is going on between chapter 1 and chapter 19, where I just want to pick up for a few moments in your hearing, because in chapter 19, in verse 20 and 21, Solomon says, "Hear counsel. Receive instruction and accept correction that you may be wise in the time to come." There is a time to come. To be honest with you, tomorrow is a time to come. We're not there yet. But there is a time to come even beyond tomorrow that we must prepare for. It's important to know that in verse 21, he says, "Many plans are in a man's mind, but it is the Lord's purpose for him that will stand." What we may see today as a tragedy, a young man at 56 losing his life somewhat suddenly, what we may see as a tragedy, God only sees it as timing. Because the Bible clearly states that our times are in his hands. And God knows the ending from the beginning. And may I insert that God knows everything in between. This is an extended conversation that a man having with his son. This could prove to be one of the most important and impactful conversations that they ever had. I want to talk to your fathers this afternoon. Have you had the conversation with your son? Has your father had the conversation? There may have been many conversations, but the one. The one that could have a lasting impact and effect on your life. Today, please hear this. Today, God sends a word out to us. God is having a conversation with all of us. To the cricketers, God's talking to you today. To the clubs, Cleveland County, Flats, Victoria, and I know that there are representatives from each county right here. Flats, Cleveland, Bellis Bay, and St. David's. God is sending out a word to the club. God's sending out a word to the counties. God is sending out a word to the citizens of this neighborhood, community, and this country. God is sending out a word to the decision makers in the clubs and the decision takers, because if you are not a decision maker, you're a decision taker. It's important that we know. And I want to say to you ladies, because many of you ladies are raising sons by yourself, you're not excluded from this conversation. He says to hear counsel, receive instruction, and accept correction. Counsel is sound advice. That's what counsel is. And the counsel that we are getting from this pulpit and from this arena today is free counsel. It's important to know that we go to lawyers and pay big money. We go to therapists and we pay big money. We go to psychologists and psychiatrists and we pay big money, but we won't go to Jesus, who gives it free. Hear counsel today. Sound advice. And then he goes on to say, receive instruction. Instruction is how to apply the counsel. You've got to receive it in your heart, and then by God's grace, begin to live it out in everyday life. Then he says, you have to accept correction. Correction is that when I realize that something is out of alignment with God's will. I don't mean with your neighbor's desire. I don't mean even with some family desire. When your life is out of alignment with God's will, it needs correction. It's important that we yield to the correction that God has given. God is the supreme authority. God is awesome. I'm telling you that God is awesome. And in his love and in his wisdom is having a conversation with us today. We want to make sure that our lives are aligned with the will of God, and that in and of itself is wise. It is called the time to come. We want to have, because of what we believe, when we hear instruction, when we hear counsel, receive instruction and accept correction, it is so that we might have a future and a destiny that's filled with delight and not despair, that is filled with eternal happiness and not hopelessness, that is filled with God-filled and Christ-centered, not self-centered. Today, God sends out his word of counsel and instruction to the generation coming behind us. I want to say to most of the cricketers today that are my age, you were blessed to be brought up in Sunday school, and now you're neglecting to take your sons to Sunday school and church. You're neglecting them. You're neglecting your nephews. You're neglecting your cousins. You're neglecting your stepchildren. You had the privilege of hearing about Jesus, the Christ, and so do your offspring. And God requires that you take up the mantle and let your children know that there is a God with whom we must give an account. Today, the generation coming behind us, many of them don't know the name Jesus, only in cursing. Many of them don't know what a church building even looks like. And I tell you, that is spiritual neglect. If it was in social services, the police would be at our house. It's important to know this, that we have a responsibility to the children that are coming behind us, especially the male children. My God. We've got to correct some things that are going on. Let me say to you, lovingly and kindly, that Christians, cricketers can be Christians. Cricketers can be Christians. Footballers can be followers. Yes, they can. Strong, outstanding, proud and upstanding. Some of the most talented and richest and influential people in sports are Christians. There is no reason why we can't be a Christian and play cricket. Honoring the name of God, there's no reason why that we as leaders cannot rally the younger people and say, God first. That's probably why we're losing so many games, but I'll leave that one alone. Those of you that are influential, those of you that are sitting in seats of authority, you've been voted into office. It's time to change some stuff around. It's time to change some stuff around. We need to say no more cricket without Christ. Hallelujah. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. I've played down here. I've played up there. I've played on every field. I know what it's like to play, and I know what it's like to play at life and miss God's best. No more county without Christ. Sons, that's your daddy's responsibility. No more soccer without the Savior. And if we do that, you're going to see a marked change in the trajectory of our community. You're going to see the community lifted, because every time you praise God, it's a sincere heart. Every time you come to God and God begins to answer prayers, you will see a change in society. Say this again, some of the most talented, influential, and richest athletes are followers of Jesus Christ and have received the gift of eternal life. I tell you, eternal life sounds good, don't it? Yeah. It is good, and it is free too, but somebody had to pay for it. Fathers, counselors, mentors, members, watch this now. There are 66 books in this Bible, and God directed me here so that this community could hear a word from Him. I sought the Lord and He heard. It's important to know, listen to me, every father that's sitting under the sound of my voice, every mentor, every counselor, every member, remember, you have leadership responsibility, not just with a cricket ball and bat, but with life. Yes. And it's important to know that anything and anybody that takes you or your family away from the path of Jesus Christ should be refused. We need to get some backbone and stand up for Jesus. You soldiers of the cross, anything and anybody that takes you from the path of God in Jesus Christ should be refused wholeheartedly and rejectedly. Why, Pastor? You're saying, why should we refuse that? Because it's unwise. A day is coming that none of us know about. A day is coming down in the future that we're going to need God. And you're going to need to know where to find Him. And the wonderful benefit and blessing of finding God is when you know Him for yourself. I wish I had a witness up in here. It's then when you don't need to call the pastor. You don't need to call the bishop. You don't need to call the elders and the deacons. But you can call upon Him for yourself. And my Bible tells me, call upon the Lord and He will answer you. And He will show you great and mighty things that you did not know. It's important, let me say this again, that anybody and everybody that takes you and your son and your family and your neighbors away from the path of Jesus Christ, you ought to refuse that counsel. You ought to refuse that instruction. And you ought to accept the correction that's coming today that says, I'm going to follow Jesus. Did I hear? I heard in the obituary that Pluke asked his mom, when the church gonna be reopened? Well, I want to say to you, church is open. Church is open. You see that church up there? The church over here, St. Philip, the Brethren Church up Harrington Sound. When we were growing up, those churches were full.
Yes.
We were taken. We were not only taken, but mom and dad went with us. They went to one class, and we went to another class. But we were all in the same building.
Yes.
I'm telling you, when revival comes in this community, and these churches begin to fill up, every Sunday these churches ought to be full. Every Sunday, pastors ought to be looking to the ushers to find some extra seats. And you know who ought to be in there? You!
Yes.
You, us, we ought to be filling these churches, looking for the grace of God that brings salvation, looking for the stability that God and God alone brings. The question is, I'm almost done. What's at stake here? What's on the line? The latter days, as the writer says, we want to be wise for the latter days. But in order for me to be wise, I got to hear something. I got to receive something. And I got to accept something. What's at stake here could possibly be drama, trauma, confusion, calamity, and emptiness in your life. But on the other side of the coin, there could be calmness. There could be the peace that passes understanding. There could be joy. There could be fullness. There could be purpose. There could be abundant and eternal life. That's what's at stake for our community. That's what's at stake for our family. How many of us are thinking seriously about the time to come? Because the time to come is coming quickly. The time to come is here today. And it's important, as the scripture says, we have to make sure that we are considering our ways. How many of us are thinking seriously? Or are we living recklessly? Saints, listen to me. It is reckless to live without God. It is reckless to be defiant against God or denying or ignoring the counsel and the instruction and the correction of God. Thinking seriously about the time. Watch this and hear this. The time that God has given. The time that God has given and God controls. People, hear me. We're not in control. We're not in charge. We don't have anything to do with which way the wind blows. We don't have anything to do with how the grass grows. We don't have anything to do with how the seasons roll in. We are in control of nothing. But I will say this, when you give your life over to control of the God of the universe and his son, the Lord Jesus Christ, you find out that life now is sweet. And my joy is complete. David said this. He said, Lord, help me to know my end. Help me, Lord. Lord, I'm going through some stuff. I see some stuff. I'm feeling some stuff. He said, help me to know my end. And what is the measure of my days? That I may know how frail I am. And many of us are eating more kale, more spinach, more tomatoes, more cucumbers, more bok choy. We're eating all the green stuff and we're still frail. This is not physical frailty. We are spiritually frail.
Yes, yes, yes.
And David was crying out, Lord, help me to know how my life is without you. I am frail. I am fickle. I am susceptible and I'm prone to wander.
Yes.
Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. This day, today, right here, right now, is ordained by God. the only thing that we did, family, in all honesty and sincerity, was make the preparations for the day. But the day was ordained by God. And it is, listen, you may not believe this, you may not receive it, you may reject it, but hear me now, hear me now. Hear the prophet of the nation. That God is using Pluke for you to hear this today. God is using Pluke so that you can have an ear to hear, and whatever you hear, that you deal with it in a sensible and responsible way. God will take and use people at his own will and at his own discretion. We are in control of nothing. One day, I'm going to be laying here. One day, you're going to be laying here. What is going to be said about you and what is going to be said about me? But more importantly, what is God going to say? Will he say to you, well done, good and faithful servant? It's time to get in touch. It's time to get in tune with Jesus the Christ and stop reasoning, stop debating, stop talking about the Lord and his word, and start obeying it. Start living it. This word is to be lived. David says, thy word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path, which means that the lamp shines right before me and the lamp shines down the road. So I've got light in the immediate area and I've got light for down the road. That's what God's word is, a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Please, I beg of you today, don't keep ignoring the word of God when you hear it. Stop debating about it. As some people always say, come on, let's reason about the word. Don't reason about it, obey it. Live it in your life, live it in your heart, and let it change your life and change those around you. The Bible says in Proverbs 3, verse 7, it says, don't be wise in your own eyes, thinking we're so smart and crafty. Yeah, we're smarter than the person in front of you or behind you, but there is one above you. He says, don't be wise in your own eyes. He says, fear the Lord and depart from evil. The worst thing you could do, the worst thing that you could do, my friends, this afternoon, is not rob, is not steal, is not murder. The worst thing that you could do, my beloved, is not lie or cheat. The worst thing that you could ever do in your life is reject Jesus. Because Jesus is the one that turns lying and cheating and stealing and murderers around. There are people that have been trying to fix stuff for many, many years and still haven't had success. But there are people that have come to Jesus and seemingly success has shown up on the borders. Why? Because he's a way maker. He's a heavy load shearer and he's a burden bearer. He makes the crooked things straight and he makes the rough places smooth. In essence, he is a savior. Please don't reject and refuse the love of God and the forgiveness of God and the correction that God gives to us in Jesus Christ. Today there is counsel for you. Today there is instruction for you. Today there is correction for you, to make you wise for your future. I may get in trouble for this, but I'm used to trouble. I heard a man from the United States Senate, he just passed away. He said, if you're going to get in trouble, make sure it's good trouble. So I'm going out on a limb and get some good trouble. Understand this. Now's not the time to get as drunk as you can. Now's not the time to get as high as you can. I'm telling you, my friends, my beloved brothers, and all that's listening today, now's the time for sobriety. Now's the time to get it together in my mind and in my spirit. Now's not the time for folly and foolishness. You don't know when the Lord's going to call any one of us home, and now's the time to sober up.
Yes.
Hear counsel, receive instruction, and accept correction, that you may be wise for your future. Brother John, would you just bring that down just for a moment? Today, there are people here that are in the valley of decision. You may never have this opportunity again, I don't know. But the Bible says, behold, today is the day of salvation. You want to make Pluke proud? Come accept Jesus. Come from wherever you are. You know what happens? We are so big and bold and we are so brash sometimes. But when it comes to something like this, we run for cover. Listen to me. Don't run from him. Run to him.
Yes.
Today, God is calling somebody and you need to be bold and proud. The Bible says that if you would confess him before men, he says, I will acknowledge you before my Father. He said it, but you reject and deny me, I will deny you before my Father. Is there one man that would say, today I'm going to begin to follow Jesus in honor of Pluke, who sat down in the back of St. Philip's, looking and waiting and hoping for the day, asking his mother when the church going to be reopened. I want to let you know this afternoon the church is open and Christ is waiting, and he's waiting for you. Is there one from way, way up there by the church, way on the back, right down front? It don't matter. Today is the day of salvation. I believe that I am here by divine appointment. I am on assignment. And today, if you hear his voice, don't harden your heart. Are you here? Come. Let's stand together as we are about to close this service. I'll meet you down here. One of our pastors will meet you down here. It's a simple process, but there's only one thing that's required, and that is you be sincere. You don't need money. You don't need influence. You don't need anything but a sincere heart. That's all you need. And when he comes, oh boy, when he comes, I say when he comes, when he comes. Are you here to my left? Are you here to my right? Are you here down the center? Please, please don't put him off today. Invite him into your life to be your Savior. That's good counsel. That's good instruction. That's good wisdom for the time to come. Let's pray. Father, you said your word would not return to you void, but it shall accomplish what you please and prosper in the thing for which you sent it. Father, today this word is going out as seed. This word is going out as water, that seed already been planted. We leave the harvest to you. We thank you for this opportunity. We thank you for the life of Carlton Pluke Smith, for everything that he contributed to this community, to his family. We pray, Father, that you would bless the family with your divine presence always. In the days, in the weeks, in the months, and yes, even the years that will come when he will be missed, bring a smile to their face. Jesus, we crown you with praise. We love and adore you. We bow down before you. Jesus, we crown you with praise. Crown this family with your peace. In the name that's above every other name, the name of Jesus. If you receive the word today, give Jesus a clap of praise. If you receive the word today, give him glory. Give him honor. The Smith family wish to announce that due to the COVID-19 regulations, there will be no gathering after the service of more than 50 people. They appreciate all the love and support from everyone that is here today, and our family wishes to host a memorial event for PLUKE once the guidelines allow us to do so. Our hope is that this will be in the near future. You'll hear about it. The family would like to thank all of you for your contributions, your thoughts and prayers, your love and support, and to the entire community of friends over the past few weeks. They thank you very much. There is a song that has been chosen that will be played, I believe, by Brother Magic. And as we make our recessional, we will do the final benediction on the hill at the interment. Thank you.
Let's see. Check, 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 check. Microphone check. One, two. Yeah, you know. Special dedication to all the Devil's Hole Massive, you know. Straight from the Soldier One Posse. Big up the man called Pluke, making his final walk to the pavilion. Let me play some music for my brethren, Pluke. Yeah? Big dedication to the Alley Cats. Big up all the Somerset.